for those of y'all who have been to church, do you think like youth ministry or church meets your needs or deals with your question seriously?
I feel like the last like youth ministry I've been to, like I feel like they just tell you to like the basics, but like I want to feel like how older people feel in church, like they be in there, not saying I want to catch the Holy Ghost or nothing like that, I'm just saying like they be really feeling it, and the pastor and the preacher be talking about stuff that really be going on in people's life. Like I don't feel that in youth ministry.
Anybody else?
When I used to visit church, I felt like the youth ministry was more of like school lessons and stuff like that, and like teach you what's right from wrong, more things about the Bible. And even as I got older into the older classes, it still didn't help me like really understand much about the Bible. Only the adult sessions would.
Do y'all feel like they don't touch on real issues?
Yeah, I feel as if youth ministers feel as if like youth don't have any problems going on, so they just try to talk about like other things like school wise, not going on personal issues, how the adult church is going on. They feel like as if the youth is everything is going good, then the youth don't have any problems. Mm-hmm.
What's a issue that you've heard in adult church where you're like, man, they should talk about this in the youth ministry?
On the verge of homelessness, not having jobs, just going through a rough time period, and it like just real like real life issues that I feel like you church don't necessarily hit on.
Mm-hmm. I got a question.
Go ahead.
If there's only one God, why are there so many different like denominations? Why do everybody misinterpret and interpret the Bible in their own way if it's only one God, one center?
That's a great question.
Well, I want to comment on the question I asked before. Like, they'll be talking about, like, character and stuff like that in the sermons. They don't really talk about that in the youth rooms. Like, they'll just tell you, like I said before, like, your rights and wrongs and stuff like that. They don't really tell you, like, the things that you need to do, like, to be, to have good character. Like, it has something to do, like, the armor. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. They didn't teach me that in the youth room. I had to listen when I was with my mom.
I got another question. Like, if, like, they like say they have a funeral or whatever for somebody, and they say like, oh, he in heaven, oh, he in a better place, this, that, and the third. But what if that person committed suicide and they still telling these people he in heaven?
Do you feel like church pastors always put people in heaven at funerals, and you know
that person was doing wrong or wasn't living right? They weren't living up to God's expectation, but y'all still telling all these people, like, setting them these stories, like, oh, he was a good person. Like, it's good. You don't want to hear the bad about somebody, but yeah. I mean, I want to hear the reality at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. You feel like they sell you dreams.
Yeah, basically. Just like on the what's the thing that they pass out with the person face on it before the funeral.
Oh, the
obituary.
The obituary. You have notes on every obituary. Be like, God has taken from us, but don't think of it as it's a negative thing because he went to heaven or she went to heaven. Or whatnot, no matter.
Or she in a better place.
No matter what situation may be, it could be a suicide, a murder, or anything of that nature. But God said, "Thou shalt not." Commit suicide, something like that, because that's.
Thou shalt not kill.
That too.
So you wondering how they kill themselves, how they repent, you wrestling with that.
And I think if it's like, if you break any commandment, but you still living the life. Do you feel like, I'm wondering, like, if any of the commandments are broken as you're living, does that mean you just not going to heaven straight up, like, as following down the line, so when your time do come, you already know you're not going?
Mm-hmm. I want to know, like, this is a real serious question, like, why pastors sit up there and preach for hours and hours and hours and then leave church and break more commandments than half the people that was inside the church?
Okay.
Like, that's like, leading the blind. That's the same thing. Like, you telling us this, that, and the third, and you telling us how God wants you to live and live for God and be for this, that, and the third, but I done seen pastors leave and light up a J, start cussing. Like, you cussing. I done seen pastors cuss in church, but I'm not saying, like, that's a, like, I don't know if that's a, like, a sin or a bad thing or whatever, but, like, you cussing in church, you in God's house. I mean, ain't, I don't care who you is, ain't no right. You ain't got no right to do that. Mm-hmm. But you still telling us you gonna go to heaven for this, that, and the third. If you doing wrong and you still telling us, and we think you the pastor, oh, you, we know you going to heaven, but you still sinning.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask, so the Bible says no sin is greater than another right. So how come murder charges and stealing charges, you steal something? Why are they not the same? You know what I'm saying? If this is God's word, then why isn't everything basically Bible related? You know what I'm saying? If no sin is greater than the other, then the punishment should be the same, right? If it's, so I wanna know why that is.
In the world, like, predominantly Christian, I guess. So they don't, the world is like predominantly Christian as well. I was wondering like the same thing too. Like, you can catch a lot of time just with stealing the bag of chips and stuff like that. Like, they take like little kind of serious. I was remembering that too.
Was the Bible around at the same time lawmakers first came about, like, making laws? And if it was, and they made, and they started saying, like, when they first made the U.S. or whatever, and they turned it into like what it is now, and they start, like, you know how they saying God we trust? How y'all saying God we trust, but y'all don't build y'all laws based off His commandments?
What are some real life issues that y'all have experienced that you feel like the church isn't addressing? Like, if you could share your story that you feel like either youth ministry never addressed or the church never addressed, what is a real life situation?
All right, basically what the youth go through, basically.
What would be a personal story?
They think adults, like, perfect and all that stuff. Like,
I don't feel as if necessarily as the church don't hit on. I just feel as if we may not feel comfortable. It was plenty of times I heard the youth ministry speak on something that was currently going on. But I just feel that they didn't, like, they were just speaking on it at the top, but they wasn't speaking from experience. I feel better expressing myself if I know as if it was someone of older speaking to you from experience. Because you just speaking on top, that means you just speaking on top, that means you haven't experienced it. But if I know it's your experience, then I may feel a connection that may make me want to be more open with you in the youth ministry. But still, you just speaking on it, I could just sit back and listen and agree with you, but me knowing that you're not speaking experience, just, I don't know, that just...
I feel like they should make it personal. Like, whatever they're talking about, don't just be up there preaching like, the Bible says this, the Bible says that, right here, go to chapter and all, like... It's good to pull things out the Bible, but don't make everything about the Bible. Pull things out the Bible to help you tell your story, help you reach out.
Her question is, like, what, give an example of a time when, like, you are going through something or something happens to you, and church is not really addressing that, whatever you're going through, or giving you answers to it that make any sense.
So, like,
think of your stories, like, think about things you've been through, if
you're comfortable. Y'all might, like, have disagreement with it, but I feel like churches don't really, really, really address, like, how I really like to get over grief. Because, like, they'll speak about it, really, but I don't feel like they give you, like, specific answers and, like, specific solutions that you can get over grief and stuff like that. Like, they even, like, bring, like, some of their life examples into it, and they'll talk about, like, they'll make it seem like it was so easy to come up out of it and stuff like that in my eyes. But I still, like, be thinking about the bad stuff, and I just, like, it didn't really help me at all.
What have you had to personally grieve?
Like, when I was, like, little, but I ain't have, like, a mindset like I got now. But when I was little, my granddaddy died. And we was at like the church the week after that, and he was talking about grief, and I was like, oh, that's kind of strange. He talking about grief because I'm going through it right now, and like he was speaking about it like in a happy manner and stuff. Like, was saying like it was easy to get through it. Oh, you just got to talk to God. You just got to take some time, and you just got to pray, and you pray everything will be healed, everything will be all right. That's what pastors always say. When you pray, everything will be okay. It's like, it's great that you leave everything in God's hands, but you got to play a part too. And your part be like, you may feel like that's like the even real harder part than God's part. And you still got to live through that while you're praying. So after you just got done praying, you got to open your eyes and you got to go back to seeing everything that's what that you're going through.
Billy?
Wow. When
Candid
was when people die, everybody always says it's in God's plan. Like, what kind of plan is that? Like, I mean, I understand, like, maybe the person might be going to a better place and stuff, but is it in God's plan that, like, the people that run the system in the country are the people, the bad people that they are? Is that in God's plan too? Or?
Yeah, that just makes sense. Like, is it in God's plan? Like, when people catch life charges and stuff like that, like, was that in God's plan and stuff like that? Because they ain't never going to be able to get out. So
that's, I don't know. I feel
it's just another reason for something.
What he was saying, like, is it in God's plan? Like, when people die, like, that, is it in God's plan to put, like, their siblings or their loved ones through that amount of hurt and their mothers? Because no matter, like, I don't know, that's just... I don't know. It's like it's. I don't know how to explain it. It's kind of. Yeah. I don't know. Cause like when you lose a close one, it could be a life sentence or a death. You're punishing someone, but you're still putting like a certain amount of people through a big amount of hurt. So is that in God's plan to make these people go through this amount of hurt? Due to you punishing someone? Or them losing someone else. Mm-hmm.
Y'all have any questions about the honor your parents commandment?
Oh my God.
Yeah. What would y'all think about what God says about honoring your parents?
I think some parents take it too far.
I feel like the church speaks out on that well.
We should not disobey our parents
and disrespect our parents. But what if our parents are like murderers? Like they abusing us, and we trying to protect ourselves. Are we gonna get in trouble by God by protecting ourselves from being abused by our parents?
Cause
it's predominant in like the black community that we don't have our fathers, and they don't be around. So how can we honor somebody that we don't even know? Like some people daddy, they'll just pop up in their life and they'll just like try to like that's like my cousin, like his daddy just popped up and he was trying to like be all cool with him and stuff like that. And he was like, well, I've been going to church lately and I just wanted to come and see my son for the first time. And he was like, he wasn't trying to accept him and stuff like that. He was like, you know, in the Bible it says you should always honor your parents. He was like, how am I honor somebody if I don't even know them?
That's a good question. Thou shalt honor thy mother and thy father. That's a tough commandment. Cause personally, I didn't have my dad. I didn't have a dad in life. Like he was just in and out. Like, and growing up, I could say like from the ages 5 to 12, 5 to 11. I feel as if them are the most important ages for young males to have their father in their life, cause they're just starting to mature and they're going through sports in middle school and like elementary school, stuff like that. But I never had that father figure to like come to football games or come check up on the school, help with homework, stuff like that. I just never had that kind of interaction with him. But when you have your father try to call you or just try to pop back in your life, it's hard to build that connection because those years when me needing a father mattered the most in you wasn't there. I just feel that it was no need for me to build that connection with you, so why should I honor you if you wasn't never there for me?
So they say we should, the work of a Christian, we should like spread the religion, like enlighten people about the. So how do I make a non-believer a believer? proper way. Like, what do I tell them? Like, is miracles this, miracles that? But what really proof do I have? Like, how can I say that this came from God and this not just something that's just, you know what I'm saying? Like, how can I just say that? You know what I'm saying? What proof do I have of that? You know, I just want to know, how can I back up everything? Like,
can I ask a question about that? Like, how do you do that? Especially like if your life kind of looks like a mess yourself, like as far as like, it's not like God just blessing you with like the perfect life because you're a believer, you're walking the line, like it's kind of a tough sell. Like, how do you do that?
Yes, that is a good question. Do y'all think that church, do you ever feel like if you went to a church where they say, if you do right, God will bless you?
Yeah.
Do you feel like you're not doing something right, or it's your fault that you're in the situation you're in?
Yeah, we were just talking about that. Like, it's a lot of, it's bad people out there who do bad, and a lot of good stuff happened to them. So, and then it's a lot of good people out there, and a lot of bad stuff happened to them. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard a message where people are like, well, if you give this amount of money, God will...
You'll get double it and you get it back?
Uh-huh.
I don't necessarily believe in that.
Mm-hmm. Me either.
That's
the church finessing you out your pocket.
Yeah, that too. But no, but all churches don't do that. They do give it to the youth and all that stuff, but other churches, they are pocketing.
Mm-hmm.
Pastor pulling up in a Jaguar, but everybody that go to the church drive 2006 Toyotas.
Oh, you go walking.
And then as you can see, like the kind of car the pastor driving, he'll probably make a sermon about if you just keep praying and have faith, you'll be driving the same kind of car I'm driving, and this and that, and just give really like bullcrap scenarios.
Yeah, it's like sometimes some churches make it seem like it's just a business. Like they always pass around the tree, like every 10 minutes.
Man, that's crazy. Lord, I went to one church, they passed the tray around three times
through
the whole thing. One day, first when you first come in, it's getting passed around. Before you eat the little
when they say God's gonna drink the grape juice,
they passing it around again while y'all walking up there. And then at the end of service, they end up singing and clapping.
While you pass around them, and
they got an offer like this.
Oh, I got another question. So the Bible says about baptism, it says you should be submerged, right? Fully submerged, right? So how come Methodists can sprinkle? Like, you ever
mm-hmm. sprinkle? Presbyterians as well.
Yeah.
They do the sprinkling.
Mm-hmm. They say submerged.
I got a question about baptism. Like, when you get baptized, how you know you, it doesn't that mean you forgive, when you forgive for all your sins that you had? How you know you forgive? How you know you forgive?
Anything that a church or a pastor or somebody talking to you as a Christian has ever said or done that has kind of turned you off from going to church or from Christianity, like something they've said or done during a sermon?
Them specifically knowing what a specific or one of the church members are going through and speaking that topic and try to use it as like a
lesson.
Yeah. And them not knowing, like them trying to speak on that, the church members may not be knowing what he's talking. They may speak, maybe think he's just speaking in German, but the one specific person may be like, if I spoke with you, because you know many people after church that speak with the pastor, mm-hmm. and then later the next Sunday that pastor probably make a sermon about the person going through. That's kind of, I feel like that's kind of disrespectful without asking the person.
And you know, you New Year's services, right? They call them revivals.
New Year's. Yeah, some churches do.
So every year they always say, we bring in a new year. Better things coming, like life not gonna be as hard, life not gonna be what it was. Like why life ain't getting no better? Like why things not happening for the better now? And it ain't happening. I've been paying attention to this, you know what I'm saying? And they get the same speech about new year coming in, you know, and God gonna bless you with new things. I just wanna know like why ain't that really happening better for me?
I had another question. It's saying in the Bible that you shouldn't like bow down to nobody but God, for nobody but God. Like, that's true, but in a way, I feel like that's true in a way, but I feel like, well, no, it's true all the way, actually. But I feel like citizens and officials, like, they manipulate that, like, when it comes to, like, police officers and stuff like that. you like they'll make it seem like you have to follow everything they saying, even when you know you dead right down in your heart, you gotta follow everything they say, or like they can like end your life type stuff. Like they holding your life in their hands, you gotta do what they say, or just like that, they can just crumble it like that. So I feel like other people like try to play God's role, and I just wonder like why people do that.
I was wondering like what does God and like what does the Bible say about like sicknesses, like, and like why people go from that, and why they can't like really be healed, or like why do they have to leave because of disease or sickness or something.
Does anybody ever wonder, there's a scripture that says, you know, God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And when you think about different things of going without, maybe struggling with, how many of y'all have struggled with homelessness? Does that bother you as far as like trying to reconcile not having a place to lay your head and God supposed to provide your needs and you being a teenager?
I believe it's all in the plan. Like it's played out to be like, it's gonna build you up to something, to be something one day.
Mm-hmm. Have you always felt that way?
Yeah, like even when I knew, when I was little, I was like, my daddy, my grandma, like, we can't do nothing about it because we don't even have it. So if you live over here, you're gonna go through the same thing. We don't know if we're gonna stay here tonight or tomorrow. So there's like, it happens. You gotta have faith in everything that you do, mm-hmm. day by day.
All right. Well, wise man told me every bad thing is not really bad. Probably you'll see it in the future. It'll be good.
Mm-hmm. Has there ever been anything y'all have been through that's caused you to lose faith?
Yes.
Losing my people back.
This is losing like friends and stuff. It's just how you questioning God, like why me? Why him? Like, did he deserve that? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, why he left me here? Why he left me here to have to deal with this pain? From losing this person, or why he left me here to have to deal with these type of situations.
And through self-depression. Like, a lot of people go through self-depression, because I did go through self-depression. Like, just don't know why you here. Like, I feel like I'm going home. So,
I used to question myself a lot. Like, me losing, like, loved ones. Like, first, when I lost my grandfather. But he used to always teach me about principles and stuff, and like what a man should always do and stuff. And he used to always tell me like do with presidents and stuff. He used to always say, "With great power comes great responsibility." And I ain't never know what that meant until it took me like a long time to understand that. But I understand now because like the higher of authority it is, like the I don't know. Just he used to always like just teach me like stuff like that.
How come, like, in the Bible it says with God anything's possible? So whenever you're praying and you pray, and, you know, you're not praying for yourself. You're praying maybe for somebody else. So you're praying for, like, somebody's health or somebody's safeness. Why, how come every time it doesn't always work out? But it says, you know, everything, with God everything is possible. And then whenever it does happen, it's always, oh, it was in the plan, or, like, you know, why can't we be taught like exactly what it was or anything? Like,
I kind of feel like I see what you're saying, but with me, I mean, I kind of had that like that thought too. But as I would start getting older, I would see like down the line everything that I'd be wishing, like if everything possible with God, I feel like we aren't having this or we aren't having that. When I'll pray for this, pray like I'll see stuff like that. It'll start to come for me down the line. Not everything, but I'll see it like slowly starting to come. But it'll be like so unclear whether you know if it's gonna come or not, and it just like make you start to lose hope.
So I wanted to know if this was God like giving me like, because Mr. J always tell me, and he tell me like, your content, your ability to like get through stuff comes from God. So like, I wonder if like going through all these things was just like a placeholder or a way for me to get stronger, like a workshop, yeah, like a trial that you're going through now. But it's better days coming, or am I going to keep going through this? You know what I'm saying? So I just want to know, like, is it better days coming, or like, is this forever?
The last few minutes we have left, I just want you to say your first name and your age. And if you could leave a final message to pastors, what would it be? Okay? Let's start with you.
I'm Kawhi. I'm 17. And I just want to leave a message saying, just make church real for the youth. Like, don't just think about the adults in the room, because youth have real problems too as well.
Billy? Hey.
My name is Billy. I'm 17. And I just want to say the same thing that Daquan said, and just try to make, you know, help the youth a lot. Help the youth a lot with, you know, problems they go through.
I'm Jabari, 17. I'm Jabari, 17. They took my questions. I just want y'all to have youth included into, you know, Yeah.
So, a quick question before we go to the next one. Would y'all rather be in there with the adults?
Yeah.
Y'all rather be in there instead of a separate ministry that y'all feel like is make-believe for kids?
Yeah, that's good. Like, they can do separate ministries, but as long as they saying, like, they're teaching the same things.
Yeah. Like, don't sugarcoat it for us because we're younger. Like, no.
Gotcha.
My name is Kumar. I'm 17. And a message that I like to leave for pastors is don't feel as if youth don't go through the same thing that adults do. And don't try to single them out just because they may be of younger age. Because due to us being maybe younger, but we all go through the same circumstances and have the same problem.
How do y'all feel when they try to bring, like, Christian rappers in to feel like it's relatable to you? Do y'all feel like that's effective?
No.
Some of them are effective, but some of them I be feeling like they just standing up there rapping just because it rhymes.
Really?
So y'all would rather hear a sermon with substance than for them to bring a Christian artist that's like a pop artist that's doing like a Christian version of Drake.
They bring a Christian comedian in there that's funny, but he got a real testimony. I come to church on Sunday.
Mm-hmm. So y'all would rather them real, not sell y'all on gimmicks.
Yes.
Yeah.
My name is Tyreek. I'm 16. And a message that I want to leave is basically just keep it real with the youth and let them know, like, what's really going on. Tell the youth the same sermon that you're telling the adult. If we're supposed to be America's future, get the future answers.
That's what's up.
My name is Christopher Wright, and I'm 18. And while I have... Well, I have a message to the pastor. It's probably like, just don't, like, you know how some of them are con artists, don't be a con artist. Like, actually help out people in the community and show that you care. Because a lot of churches out here, they seem like they're okay. They just make them come in there for a long time and waste their time and just don't, just say words and they don't give back to the community. So, yeah.
My name is Devin. 17. And the thing I tell pastor is, you know, we're the next adults up. We're the next up. So we would like to hear the same thing that the adults hear. We're going to be adults. We have to live that life that the same adults are living. We got similar problems as adults. We want to hear the same thing.
My name is Chris. I'm 16. I want to tell the pastor, like, live what you're preaching. Like, don't be a hypocrite. Like,
amen.
You want to teach it. You live it too, like, you want to see it in you.
And don't even, it's not even that, you just, at least even if you say it, try your best. Don't even just try your best to not do it. Don't be a hypocrite, tell me not to smoke weed, and you still smoke weed. Like, no.
Jewelry Project's Questions for God.